name is Relina Joseph. I'm a professor here in the communication department and the director of the Center for Communication, Difference, and Equity. And I need to tell you all, as you see, probably popping up on your screen, that the meeting is being recorded. So if you push continue, you're consenting to it being recorded. If you could do that, please. If I could remind everyone to please mute yourselves as we're going forward as well. We're going to have a question and answer period towards the end. And please feel free to put your questions in the chat, and you can raise your hand digitally. You probably also just raise your hand like that. There's not that many of, well, no, there actually are a lot of us. Maybe raise your hand digitally. And Anu is going to be monitoring that and will let us know when folks have their hands up. So I wanted to say that we are incredibly lucky to have Dr. André Brock visiting us via cyberspace here today. Dr. Brock is an associate professor of media studies at Georgia Tech. His scholarship examines racial representations in social media, video games, Black women, and weblogs, whiteness and technoculture, including innovative and groundbreaking research on Black Twitter. One of those groundbreaking pieces in my in-print introduction to Dr. Brock was a 2012 article from the Journal of Broadcasting and Electronic Media that he wrote entitled From the Black Hand Side, Twitter as Cultural Conversation. If you haven't picked up this piece, please do. It really is a groundbreaking piece. In it, Dr. Brock compellingly argues that technology must be understood, quote, as a cultural rather than simply a social endeavor. My in-person introduction to Dr. Brock came about through our joint participation at the Race and Media conferences, including the one that we hosted here 2 years ago at the University of Washington, where Dr. Brock provided provocative, probing, and innovative insight into everyone's papers, whether they wanted them or not. And he also workshopped some of the ideas that I believe that we will hear here today. And I feel like chewing on some of the things that I learned about. So we're going to hear some more of those. So I'm interested, Dr. Brock, in hearing you to reframe some theories of the libidinal economy through Afro-optimism and not Afro-pessimism. So that's one of the things I'm going to ask you about. You're going to soon witness that André Brock is a scholarly juggernaut, as you're going to hear him work through all of his theories with high theory and popular culture in all kinds of really impressive ways. And I just wanted to also say that while I was personally looking forward to hosting Dr. Brock and having him join us not only here at the University of Washington, but also at a community book event at the Northwest African American Museum with our friends from Blacklight at Microsoft, it does feel apt that he is joining us via the interwebs, since he is an expert on the topics. And we are, of course, going to hear him speak about his recently published and much anticipated book, Distributed Blackness, African American Cybercultures. Distributed Blackness is published by New York University Press in their Critical Cultural Communication series. And so without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. André Brock.
Shout out to my label mate, Relina Joseph, whose series I also belong to. Greetings, everyone. Before I begin, thank you, Relina, for the invite, and also thank Christine Harrell, Megan Jeffrey, Anu Hastings, and everyone else at University of Washington for making this happen. Virtual greetings to you all. Okay, so we're going to see if this split screen thing works, this share screen thing, so give me a second to set it up. All right, let's go. This talk is drawn from my NYU Press book, Distributed Blackness, African American Cybercultures, which, although I would love if you would buy it, I would also urge you to encounter it in its open access form, and I'll share that link on my final slide. Today, I'll highlight some of the theoretical grounds and empirical evidence I use to support my claim that Black people are natural denizens of the internet. My work on race in the digital is grounded by a three-part formulation of technology, or technoculture, that technologies must be understood as an artifact, a practice, and a belief. The digital is often only understood as the first two, that is, what the technology is and what technology does, leaving uninterrogated Western beliefs about culture and technology, whiteness and technology, or Western technoculture. In many cases, these beliefs are often presented as hosannas to the twin deities of innovation and disruption, masking their very real destructiveness to our social fabric. Belief is very much a cultural phenomenon, but it is as difficult to apprehend as water is to a fish. To make this research work, I needed to find a way to systematically investigate how belief manifests before technology use, within technology artifacts and technology practices, and after technology diffusion to the public or to businesses and deployment. I have long been bemused when it comes to culture by the connotation of race, particularly in respect to information technologies. Far too often, race is only ascribed to non-whites, leaving whiteness to embody the unmarked yet default digital practitioner. As Ron Aglash notes, in white racial ideology, Blacks are marked as primitives, as beings of uncontrolled emotion and direct bodily sensation, rooted in a soil of sensuality. These attributes render Black folk as incapable of the rationality and objectivity apprehended as virtues of technology and of white masculinity. This apprehension, this capture, is far from accidental. Whiteness draws its energies or libidinal tensions from its fraught relationship with anti-Blackness. The carceral fixity of Blackness allows whiteness to possess what Richard Dyer calls interpretive flexibility, where white racial identity is highlighted as individual endeavor, even as it recedes into the background to become universal personhood. Every other group is marked by its differentiation from that norm. The digital has a similar interpretive flexibility thanks to its characteristics of virtuality and simulation. Consider your experiences using someone else's phone or web browser. While they are familiar devices to you, everyone configures those devices according to their own needs and desires. From this perspective, I ask you to understand the internet as an unmarked, individuated common space until you get to a space that falls out of the norm, such as Jezebel.com or Black Planet. These spaces where marginalized digital practitioners congregate are seen only as niche online destinations, never universal, despite the millions of people that flock to them daily. So I talk about technoculture a lot in this book. It's the title of my book, and I go off on it in multiple ways every time I give this talk. And one way to define technoculture is the beliefs, the relations between, and the politics of culture and technology. Joel Dinerstein argues that technology is the American mythos, and I list here his Western technocultural matrix, which describes the libidinal tensions, the categories that power beliefs about technology in the West. They are progress, religion, whiteness, modernity, masculinity, and the future. Strangely enough, these tensions trick off of the racial ideology of whiteness to form what we love to call a good society. That is, these qualities of progress, religion, and modernity could easily be substituted as the characteristics of white folk. Indeed, W.E.B. Du Bois argues as much in his autobiography, Dusk of Dawn. When tied to technoculture, white racial ideology reserves the quality of control over enterprise, over the spirit, over the future, and the natural and man-made world, and deems them as their norms for technology use. In this simulation, Black bodies are objects to be acted upon, or as Ramona Morrow calls them, Black technical objects, rather than agents or people with subjectivity. And none of those formulations would do for a book on Black technoculture. To argue for Black technoculture, then, it was necessary for me to interrogate the ways that Black culture makes sense of itself as technocultural subjects, utilizing technical artifacts, services, and platforms, which may not have been designed for them, but are in use by them in our socio-historical context. Reorienting technoculture to incorporate Blackness invites an inquiry into the possibilities of Blackness as technology. But how to articulate a Black presence and a technoculture designed around their chattel origins and political death. And I'll revisit that later in the presentation. But one way to start off answering this question starts with a callback to a seminal print cultural artifact, the Green Book. As you remember, this critically acclaimed movie featured a white protagonist helping a black man discover his blackness on a road trip through the southern United States. Oh wait, that's not the right Green Book. What I meant to cite is this Green Book. Victor Green, a postman in the United States, created this artifact in 1941. And for those of you who are interested in exploring it further, several scanned editions are available for free on the New York Public Library website. On first glance, the Negro Motorist Green Book is just a book, a directory of black businesses published by blacks for blacks long before the internet. And scholars have argued for it as a tool of resistance to post-colonial and post-bellum legacies of white racial violence and hegemony. I agree, but I insist that the NGB, because I can't say Negro Motorist Green Book too many times, I'll start to stutter. The NGB should also be viewed as one of the first cultural-oriented network browsers. The network, in this instance, was the United States highway system, a developing transportation infrastructure tailored for the exponentially growing numbers of automobile owners. As early as the 1910s, Black drivers saw automobile ownership as a pathway to personal mobility, technological expertise, and a signal of belonging to the middle class, the American middle class, not just the Black middle class, but with a perspective which came with the attendant properties of racial uplift ideology. Arguing for the NGB as Black technoculture, an informational artifact linking Black information seekers to Black cultural resources, then seems like a no-brainer. The NGB was the Google of its time, or for you old heads, the Yahoo Open Directory, a search engine for those seeking culturally vital, and in this case, protective and vivifying information. As I mentioned, the NGB imagined the United States highway system as a Black technological network, not as an Afro future, but as a modern marvel containing possibilities for spanning time and space while experiencing joy and limiting possibilities for violence. And we have reconceived this particular notion as safe spaces. Reorienting technoculture then to incorporate Black agency invites an inquiry into the possibilities of Blackness as technology, not Black bodies, been there, done that, but Black folk as technical experts, employing an ethics of care to make a dollar out of 15 cents. While the internet doesn't offer quite the same physical potential for discrimination and racist violence against Black bodies, there is still a pressing need for the curation of digital and online resources for Black folks seeking information. In short, networked cultural information, or as my book is titled, Distributed Blackness, is essential to Black identity in the form of resources for identification, community, self-defense, joy, resistance, aesthetics, and more. So at this point, I've said libidinal at least twice, and I should tell you why. For me, I mentioned operationalizing belief and libidinal economy, and here I'm citing Lyotard. For those people who love Deleuze and Guattari, we'll talk later. But Lyotard's libidinal economy offers a powerful counter to rationalistic, modernist, and political economic theories used to understand both Black agency and information technology uses. Political economic theories are themselves beholden to belief about Black folk and about economic activity, leading to either deficit models like the digital divide, or conversely, to glorifying Black capacities for labor and political resistance. Libidinal economy makes clear the affective tensions undergirding modernity and Western technoculture, while also providing a path towards conceptualizing Black technology use as a space for the mundane, for the banal, and the celebration of making it through another day. The libidinal is not precognition, nor is it pre-intention. Instead, it can be understood as the combustion powering the engine, a visceral, powerful, and necessary component in any figuration. It is infrastructure, invisible to our perceptions, just like the materials and processes that we utilize every day until a rupture occurs. A libidinal economic perspective, then, on Black technoculture allows for the teasing apart of the multi-layered reasons behind Black digital practices, distribution, performance, and aggregation across digital and material social structures. Think of D-Nice's quarantine DJing on Instagram, and you'll begin to understand the different impulses and tensions that power that particular type of performance. Black folk use technologies not designed for or about them in ways that confound traditional technology analyses. And this approach in distributed Blackness is intended to redress that shortcoming. This approach offers multiple beneficial outcomes. One is the disinvestment in technoculture's substrate of logic and rationality. For those of you who understand the Instagram term demon time, you'll understand exactly what I mean. However, logic and rationality are also invested with libidinal tension. They require the divestment of emotion from cognition in order to achieve an objective decision or the abstraction of humanity in order to serve an economic purpose. Libidinal economy and its formulation as an excess of life expands my book, my inquiry from productivity or efficiency to incorporate analyses of digital practice engendered by joy or sexuality, or playfulness, or even anger. Or in the book, I call these things ratchetry, racism, and respectability. Another beneficial outcome for this book is the acknowledgement and theorization of Black communal identity as a meaning-making strategy in online discourse. This allows for understanding Blackness as a discourse and conversation with, but not wholly subject to, white supremacist ideology and a refutation of the categorical nature of capitalist identity. So I may have mentioned earlier, because these slides change depending on which lovely audiences I get to talk to, but I may have mentioned earlier that Blackness in the West is carceral. It is lived as social and political death, a position now linked with the powerful theory of Afro-pessimism. Frank Wilderson in Red, White, and Black argues that because Black folk have no legible stature in the West as political agents, they have no inalienable rights to Black cultural production, or Lauren Jackson's conceptualization of digital blackface. Thus, Blackness in online spaces and elsewhere is immediately captured by white Western culture, leaving little possibility for Black emancipation from that framework. I agree, kind of. But instead of arguing for emancipation through appropriate digital practice or even commodification and economic success, my pressing concern for Black technoculture is to express the vitality, the joy, and the multiplicity of Black uses of information and communication technologies, along with all other technologies of the everyday. While these libidinal impulses may become commodified or surveilled, they are para-ontological in that the embodied cognition they express pre-exist the platforms upon which they are published, visible, and deemed appropriate for consumption. Let me lighten this up a little bit by offering you an example of Black technoculture, which is often grounded in Black cultural commonplaces. The audio may not play for you, but you'll understand once I press play on this slide. So this first example features a Black cult figure, and I'm citing Kristen Warner, and character actor who has become notorious for his expression of amusement, disdain, sarcasm, and even cruelty. I have a second example, however, and it is part of a moment when Twitter made a tectonic shift in how it presented information to the world, the move from 140 to 280 characters. This move met with anger and other mixed reactions. In my 2012 article, I wrote that part of Twitter's ritual cathartic power, or the ways that it expresses emotion within a tightly constrained format, right, is the sharply enforced limitation of the 140 character limit. This tweet, however, proves me wrong. For Black technological aesthetics, utility and efficiency are not the ultimate aims. Ron Walcott, in describing the blues, which I see as similar to Black Twitter's expressive power, explains. He says that the blues is a struggle to order that space into a distinctive and comprehensive style, a style all the more distinctive for its unstinting generosity of spirit and unfailing faithfulness to the complexities of human experience, and comprehensive because it is the product of a vision that accommodates a tragicomic sensibility. He continues by saying that citing Walcott, that Black digital practice embodies, abstracts, expresses, and symbolizes a sense of life. That is, the fixed perception of self that has been inflicted upon Black folk by Western technoculture, or Fanon/Althusser's Hail, is a record of one should be and has been under that regime. When a policeman tells you to stop, you are apprehended as a object of the policeman's regard or a criminal in that moment. However, your identity is what one does after the hail. My argument then is that style and invention are crucial components of Black identity. They are how Black folk negotiate the informational and institutional strictures and regimes of anti-Blackness online and elsewhere. There are other modes of inquiry for Blackness and the digital, however. For those of you in the know, Afrofuturism is a marvelous construct through which to examine Black engagement with and through technology. But where Afrofuturism is concerned with Black futures as expressed through the arts, Black cyberculture is better argued for as the post-present, particularly as constructed and contested through Black cultural digital spaces and practices. By post-present, I mean that Black folk in digital spaces are constantly engaged with the moment, or kairos. And if you've ever tried to enter a group chat after something has been discussed, you know what kairos means. I'm using kairos here to articulate Black digital practice as a celebration of the now, one that incorporates past iniquities and future imaginings. So Black kairos is simultaneously racial performance, discursive invention, and appropriate timely engagement within communicative and cultural context. For example, timeliness, or the lack thereof, is a significant and well-known aspect of Black identity. For example, the concept of colored people time describes a joyous disregard for modernity and labor capitalism, or as the sage Kanye West has said, "I might be late, but I'm always on time." Black kairos, as deployed here, refers to the immediacy of protocols, communal structures, and the instantaneity and archival capacity of information networks. For example, showing the receipts is one Black discursive digital practice situating past transgressive behavior, often in the form of tweets from 5 years ago or other digitized documents, but occasionally in the form of televisual or audio testimony. And it situates this transgressive behavior in the now, usually via social media, to be commented upon and, scare quotes, read in the, as evidence in the moment. Similarly, one can see the Black post-present within Black feminists, womanist and queer Twitter's mobilization against social and cultural affronts, also known as call-out culture, or by the mainstream media and certain commentators as a mob mentality and cancel culture. So let me go dark for a second. I mentioned earlier that in Distributive Blackness, I examined three frames, libidinal frames of Black digital practice: racism, ratchetry, and respectability. By libidinal frame, I mean, as I said before, that beyond productivity or commodification, there are underlying tensions that contribute to the content you see online. And so let me turn briefly to the one frame that describes an external influence on Black digital practice, which is racism. Pause for a second while I plug in my laptop, which is about to die. And I'm back. All right. So racism in the book, I argue, is the set of external practices, institutions, and beliefs that deprecate and delineate, but do not overdetermine Black identity. That is, not every Black activity is determined by the racism Black folk experience through daily or systemic macro or microaggressions. For distributed blackness, I wanted to pay attention to the practice of online. I wanted to shift scholarly attention from the practice of online racism to the effects of online racism, because I feel that they had not been as thoroughly researched. And I argue that racism implicitly and explicitly compels Black interiority through the libidinal frame of reflexivity. In part because while the explicit experience of racism is often egregious, the implicit is more damaging over time. William Smith describes this as racial battle fatigue. And this phenomenon can often be engendered online by the continual reproduction and promotion of images of Black death at the hands of white folk, rest in peace, Armand Aubrey, or the state. In experiencing racism, Black folk must evaluate both the ontology and the epistemology, the what and the why of white supremacy, while navigating how it affects them. Those of you in the know understand, for example, that microaggressions require daily vigilance to assure that one's sanity has not been compromised. In online spaces, networked libidinal tensions arise from the diffusion of racist and racialized content through social media practice, connectivity, and algorithm publishing. Many of you may have seen people on your timeline asking folk not to publish, Sean King, not to publish images of Black death in their social media feeds, because they will not just see them once, they'll see them multiple times. And I call this phenomenon, this continued publishing of affronts to Black agency, weak tie racism. And I argue that racism manifests through the digital and online media's affordances for sharing information, including but not limited to algorithmically published social media content. And here I'm drawing from Lisa Nakamura's super dope article called Glitch Racism, where she argues that racism is not a glitch of the online, but a feature. These microaggressions, these publications of these videos have no author, and they are not individually performative. There's no person running up to you in your face and calling you out your name. Instead, the algorithm serves them up as a composite of developer and network beliefs about white online sociality, leading to an anti-Black libidinal effect and affect on Black digital practice. The algorithm is the catalyst and the weak tie relationship between content and user, demanding as it does its own interaction and reciprocity as it sustains the relationship between the user and the network. And we can come back to this later. I'm still working through this, so if you have questions about it, please let me know. I'm happy to hear them. So, heading towards a closing, this is my Black technocultural matrix with the qualities of Blackness, intersectionality, invention/style, America, modernity, and the future. America is an asterisk because I understand that Blackness is a diasporic imperialist phenomenon. And Fred Moten argues, and as well as Achille Mbembe, they argue that there was no Blackness when Africans lived in their own particular spaces on the continent. That is something that was created by the economic and imperialistic policies that brought Black folk to this country, to Brazil, to the West by the millions. In the interest of time, I'll only discuss one of these qualities, although we can return to them in the Q&A if you wish. I put a number on the slide, so write it down if you need it. Blackness, for this matrix, stands for the embodied and critical valences of Black cultural identity, revolving around subjectivity and cultural production, right? There's also a communal element to this as well. So it's not only your intent to be Black. It's not what you do when you're doing that Blackness. It's also the community's recognition of your Blackness or the refutation of racial dolezal. One reason why Blackness is necessary for a theory of Black technoculture is that information and communication technologies have long afforded Blackness space within which it can luxuriate and grow. Enclaved from, or is it enclave? Never remember. But never free from white racial ideology. This possibility exists because of the disembodiment enabled by virtuality and simulation. That is, when participating in an online space, Blackness lives as an existential here, largely unrestricted by the fixity and reduction of the Black body that occurs offline. Online, I am not only a point of view, but I am also a point that is viewed. The matrix category of Blackness, then, is the communitarian enactment of intentionality across cultural aspects of Black culture, and that Blackness is irreducibly social. Along the way, the matrix quality of Blackness highlights how the white Western libidinal economy of anti-Blackness, the belief in logic and rationality that excludes Black agency, structures the world that Black Americans find themselves in. As a counter, I develop Black pathos as a way to begin with the celebration of Black thought, not just joy in terms of celebration, but in our own recognition of our humanity and existence. From this perspective, Black pathos is at once a response to the effects of modernity and white supremacy on the Black psyche, and a politics of the erotic, engaging with quote unquote honest bodies that like to fuck, and here I'm citing Joan Morgan, as well as an ethics of care, right? Where whiteness gains power from obscuring its internal differences and organizing the world for its aims, Blackness is a recognition of that which makes Black folk different. Finally, the central claim of my book, as I mentioned at the start, and indeed my entire research stream, is that Black folk have a natural affinity for the internet and for digital media. By natural, I am by no means arguing that internet use is an essential quality of Blackness, like the love of watermelon, the ability to cook collard greens, or playing basketball. Because essentialism for non-whites has a long pejorative history within Western culture. Only non-white bodies suffer reduction to a perceived intrinsic characteristic, as you may have witnessed when you saw armed white men storm the capital of various state governments and not even be touched, right? As opposed to John Crawford, who was examining a toy rifle in Walmart and was gunned down within 6 seconds by police upon encountering him in the store. My claim here is pragmatic, because I was concerned that black expressivity is rightfully lauded in literature and art. And here I'm referencing Afrofuturism. But Black linguistic expression, African-American vernacular, or some of you may be familiar with the outroar against Ebonics 30 years ago, I'm sorry. And so it's denigrated in modern, i.e. technical and professional society. There is no code switching in these technical spaces. Indeed, Black identity is associated with many things, but the internet, or more specifically, an expertise in information and communication technology practice, is not usually one of them. This claim is also ecological, that Black folk have made the internet, the spaces that they enjoy and encounter one another, a Black space whose contours have become visible through their sociality and distributed digital practice, while decentering whiteness as the default internet identity. And I came upon this understanding, this eureka moment, while watching Black Twitter trending topics lead to the top of the Black Twitter hashtags lead to the top of Twitter's trending topics. That is, a service which is formulated by geeks for geeks was instead captured by the Black joy in, depending on whatever it is you might have wanted to see, the Nigger Navy, Thanksgiving for Black families. There are so many other things we could talk about. These particular moments of Black sociality have took over a space and made it clear what the ultimate purpose, as Chris Sacco, an activist investor in Twitter, has argued for, that Black Twitter is the actual normal use case for what Twitter is. I'm also arguing that Black folks' natural internet affinity is as much about how Black folk understand themselves and employ digital artifacts and practices as it is about how Blackness is constituted within the material and virtual world of the internet itself. I am naming these Black digital practices, online spaces, racial enactments and performances, and cultural phenomena online as Black cyberculture. In closing, because I have a little bit of time, my claims for informational Blackness and Black cyberculture are indebted to Paul Gilroy's Black Atlantic, where he argues that analyses of Black modernity require attention to formal attributes of expressive culture and a distinctive moral basis. Those of you who have read my article, Critical Technocultural Discourse Analysis, will immediately recognize my arguments that if you are studying digital media, you need to recognize the mediating effects of the technology in which these discourses occur from the perspective of the people using those artifacts. The aesthetic, which the continuity of expressive culture preserves, derives not from dispassionate and rational evaluation of the object, but from an inescapably subjective of the contemplation of the mimetic functions of artistic performance and semiosis. I read this in the context of Black technoculture as a plea for researchers to interrogate the functions of digital media and information technology. They do not just serve as conduits for Black expression, but are inextricably linked through enactment as part of the performance itself. Similarly, information and communication technology serve as conduits and enactments of white identity as well. This has never been more clear since the ascendancy and impeachment of the 45th president, whose Twitter activities have been translated into Supreme Court decisions, executive orders, employment mandates, domestic and foreign policy, and even injunctions to the legislative and judicial branches of the government. As with other expressions of white xenophobia, classism, racism, and misogyny, it's tempting and depressingly common to attribute 45 social media presence to the actions of a deviant individual. However, as the public intellectual and activist Alyssa Milano recently learned, this is the America she grew up in. Apart from the election of a Black president, little has changed. Black people been new. Thank you very much. And again, hurry up and screenshot it or take a picture. This is the open access link for Distributed Blackness. If you are a graduate student and you want a copy that you can annotate on your computer, hit me up in my Twitter DMs and I will send you a copy you can annotate, no charge. All right, so I'm gonna stop the screen share now so I can see all your smiling faces, and we can go to the Q&A.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. So I think that I am gonna start us off and then we'll open this up for questions. So I have a bunch of questions. And I think the one that I wanted to begin with, Dr. Brock, is one of appropriation and hearing a little bit about where you stand on questions of appropriation. And I was thinking about this in two regards. One was, so my daughter was showing me the Megan Thee Stallion twerking. I see Michelle. the TikTok, the Megan Thee Stallion twerking TikTok, which I don't know if you've seen that Dre, and as well as poor imitations of it, right? So these questions of authorship. And then I was reading Kyra Gaunt's article thinking about Miley Cyrus and twerking, right? And even in the Gaunt's kind of careful attempts to give a genealogy to twerking, there's of course huge gaps there. So thinking about all of the historic thefts from Black culture, I wanted to hear you talk a little bit about the role of authorship, what do we make sense of in terms of Black theft, and particularly in thinking through, if you can link this up with the way in which you're understanding the libidinal economy, and particularly that link to Afro-optimism, because that's where I'm still trying to kind of hold on to in your argument. I know that's a big question.
I was about to say, good Lord.
Sorry. Yeah. But just to riff off of kind of appropriation, and then to take that to some libidinal economy in Afro-optimism.
So the history scholars may be aware of, I think it's Eugene Genovese, where he talks about that slavery irrevocably transformed white people as well as Black people. Like they took on particular affect and experiences and beliefs from their close proximity to the African body, right? And so from that, I moved to Andrew Sullivan, who I hate to cite, but I have to. He said, white Americans don't realize how black they are. Right? From a UK perspective, white Americans in many ways are just as black as the people they claim to want to distance themselves from. And so from those two takes, I argue that while appropriation is a very real thing, right? If we could talk about Kim Kardashian selling bonnets for you to sleep with your hair pulled up at Saks, right? It's a very real thing, but it's a real thing stemming from their deep intertwinement with blackness, right? The appropriation comes up when people perceive that certain economic or aesthetic resources are not being shared equitably, but that's not what capitalism does. That's not what the attention economies of the internet do. And for this, I'm reaching as far back as 2008, when there were a number of black bloggers who were deeply supportive of Barack Obama's campaign and felt that because there was a black man running for president and they were black bloggers, that they should have been given press credentials to the Democratic National Convention. The Democratic National Convention, however, was like, we have all these white folk who have millions more followers than you do, many more page views and the like. So they use these alternative instrumental metrics to say these efficient qualities of representation are much more important than your cultural claims of representation. Does that make sense? And so this is why I cite Wilderson. I think he's right when he says that black folk are not allowed to have either a political presence or an aesthetic presence in white Western technoculture or the arts in which he's arguing for in red, white, and black. However, comma, if you go back to Benjamin and Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, he gives me a way to step away from authorship in part because and here I'm looking at Barth's ways of understanding libidinal. The internet makes it clear that it really does you no good to limit authorship to one person. I say this because if you've ever tried to explain a tweet that's funny, that has you dying with laughter to somebody who isn't on Twitter, the first thing they ask you is, well, who wrote that? Right. You're like, it don't matter who wrote that, right? One, it's funny, and two, it's funny. Right. And so that idea that the author retains final authority in the disposition of the content that they wrote has been really kind of fragmented with the ways that online media has this voracious appetite to reproduce, repurpose, and distribute content. Right. Mm-hmm. To the point where TikTok only allows attribution for music, which is how Jalea Burrell got caught up with the Renegade Dance. Right. Mm-hmm. She created it. These other creators took it up and did it much worse, very stiffly. They looked like 1, 2, 3, 4, right? They did it very stiffly. TikTok correctly compensated K Camp for his Renegade song, but there was no space to attribute Jalea Burrell for her creation of the dance. It was only a rupture when these young white women got invited to the blackest sport possible, the NBA All-Star game, that people were like, no. Somebody came up with this, and that's not these people, and we need to give her credit, right? So the network is designed, and I would argue the internet and its infrastructure is designed to reproduce content across multiple nodes to avoid what they called the intervention of noise on the transmission of data, right? If you can reproduce it clearly across multiple nodes, then that's an optimal outcome for the internet. It doesn't care who transmitted it until you're doing forensics stuff, right? The purpose is the reproduction of that data. So, okay, I'm wondering. So to talk about appropriation in this context revolves some nuance. It involves that you approach the topic with nuance. So Lauren Jackson's article on digital blackface, which is, when you think about it, a really compelling title, digital and blackface, boom. I understand both of those words, but when you pick it apart, right, would you say that the activities of on Living Single, Erica Alexander, would you say that the facial expressions that she did on Living Single that are captured in a GIF, would you say that's blackface? Beyonce's reaction to it? Of sipping on her drink while she walks away, is that blackface? No. right? And so the use of these reaction gifts by both Black folk and by white folk are more using them for a libidinal reaction than they are necessarily trying to appropriate them for their own use. I mean, how do you keep it to yourself, right? Are they making fun of it? Sometimes. But for the most part, white folk really don't have as many expressions of expressivity, I'm sorry, that's redundant, as many articulations of expressivity and reaction, because that's what they have us for. We have long been that overreaction to certain things, and it's very legible on our faces. One of my favorite tweets talked about how, why is it that when Black folk are in a group and laugh at something, why do they all run in different directions? Right? Because we can't contain ourselves. Our laughter is not just ha ha ha, it's also in our bodies, right? Manifest. In our faces, in our spirit, right? And so I wanted to capture with distributed Blackness that libidinal intensity, right? The fact that we bring embodied cognition to everything we do, even in these digital spaces. I think that's 3/4 of your question.
Yeah, no, I think that is. And that certainly, to me, it provides the counter to the what ends up being, I think, the ultimate kind of flatness of Afro-pessimism. But where I think the frustration still lies is that it's, to use your language, it's relying upon us to provide the noise, right? Mm-hmm. So that we are still the ones who have to provide the noise, because there is no respect for our authorship, right? But I hear you.
And respect is a tough word, right? Because the fact that you're used, okay, so if the GIF format allowed attributions of the source material, which it really doesn't, if you look on tenor.gif or giphy.com, the GIFs are not labeled according to the property which they were taken from. So that attribution has already been taken. Tiffany Pollard gets no money from her GIF reactions, right? But strangely enough, Giphy gets no money from her GIF reactions, right? Giphy had to build a whole platform, and you can talk to Jasmine Lofton about this, who now runs the Netflix Black Culture vertical, right? You can talk to her because she was the head of Black cultural content at Giphy for some time. Giphy had no idea how to either employ or deploy Black expressions of reaction. She spent a lot of time and energy making sure that our reactions were visible, so that people like me would, instead of, because I scroll past all the white people doing reactions on my thing, I'm looking for Dulé Hill, right? Or Michael Jackson, or other Black cult figures. Michael Jackson is not a cult figure, but Dulé Hill kind of is, right? To do my expression, because those are the faces that I identify with, right? And so there is no mode of compensation built within the technologies themselves. So is it appropriation if the technology never allowed it? This is where Afro-pessimism comes in, right? But I take the opposite approach, because I say Afro-optimism is a celebration that we are seeing Black faces at all. Because Giphy didn't have a lot of Black faces, neither did Tenor.gif, right? And so the addition of those faces to those representational structures is deeply empowering to me, right? And as well, it may be to your children, right?
And so,
think of it in terms of the emoji, right? You remember when emoji were all just, you know, that one little yellow looking thumb? And now I get into arguments with people because they say my emoji are too dark for my skin tone. Beg your pardon? I'm the blackest person I know. However, I'm always going to choose a darker color than the one that's available to me, because I want you to be clear that I am Black. Does that make sense? But there are mechanisms being built in, but it's always going to be additive from this point, because the base and the superstructure of the internet was not formulated with us in mind. That's a lot of answer. Is nodding, so I think I'm doing good.
I have more, but let's go to other people. I know other people have got some questions here, so I don't know if people want to ask questions.
I don't know if you can see me. I have a question.
Go ahead, Christine.
It's kind of a, I don't know if it's a fully articulated question, but it's kind of a cluster of concepts that you have brought together that I find really interesting, and I would kind of like to put it to you and see what you think. So I love that you raised the concept of kairos and as it relates to kind of react, like what you were just talking about with reactivity and responsiveness. So like the classical understanding of kairos is that it's a present moment oriented, but it's also, because it's present moment oriented, it's this capacity for responsiveness to the other, to one's environment, versus, at least in the classical tradition, it was in distinction from a mode of expression that was a priori, where you had this planned message that you are then going to execute to your audience, versus one that's more responsiveness and like, oh, I can see I'm losing people, I need to pivot or whatever, right? And so when I teach it to students, I'll often use, I don't even know if it's a good analogy because I'm not a sports person, but I compare it with like American football versus something like basketball or soccer, where it's less about executing a strategy and it's more about responding to the environment, to the other, and all of that. It's more bodily, it's more corporeal in some ways. And it's more distributed versus a linear kind of strategy model. And so I guess the way you're talking about it, I think is really interesting. And I just wondered if you could talk about it in terms of one version is a certain version of power. I have a plan. I'm then going to tell other people how to execute that plan, or I'm going to tell people how to respond to my message, versus one that's more chaotic, which you're attributing to a kind of Black distributed, it's responsive, it's more in the moment. I'm just interested, that's a different kind of power, like a making do, like all the kind of concepts you're sort of pointing to. And I'm just kind of interested in the ways in which those two different versions of power or agency, I'm fascinated that you went with Kairos. It's not one I would have thought of, but then once you raised it, it made perfect sense to me.
A really good example of Kairos is in the mid-2000s, blogs were the primary mode of online communication, at least for the everyday person, right? In many ways, blogs have been supplanted or integrated into online platforms. Many newspaper websites are powered by WordPress, MP, and other spaces. But for a time, the blog, with its lengthy exposition, right, and the ability for the author to go forth for multiple paragraphs, was the primary way that people communicated. And I see that as a precursor to the kairos that social media affords its users, where the give and take, particularly for the microblog structures of Twitter and Tumblr, but also for the chat mediums such as Snapchat, WhatsApp, and the like, that kairos, that being in the moment of the moment, does not necessarily mean that it is less powerful. I agree with you there. It does, however, turn upon the invention and creativity in the moment of the moment, as opposed to having time to plan out and speak your entire speech without being interrupted, like my wife tries to do, right? Instead, she can hear me, so I'm sure I'm gonna get hit later, right? Instead of having that long discursive monologue, now you have to do the give and take, right? Twitter limits it intentionally. Instagram didn't until recently. So if you've ever seen an Instagram comment, it may have looked like kairos, right? But it was 1600 comments without any spaces. It was intensely difficult to read, right? And so the internet mediums that we participate on have moved us toward this moment where sociality and communicability have become intertwined. Right. And in those spaces, particularly with the instantaneous transmission of information, kairos becomes preeminent. Right. Think about how I mentioned Twitter switched to 280 and how it began. Twitter also introduced a feature at the time called the tweet stream, right, where you could reply up to the, for some people I follow do 60 at a time. Andy Slavitt, who you should follow if you don't, to keep up with Medicare and the coronavirus response, will do 60 tweet threads. Right. And in some ways, they would represent that intention of power where I control the discourse all the way down, but Twitter, in breaking it up and making it only 280 chunks, allows us to respond to each chunk in real time, or later on, 8 hours later, right? And so kairos is that immediately interesting to me because it also affords Black expressivity and invention, which is, I talk about signifying in my Twitter article, it's a deeply embedded part of Black discursive identity, Black identity, right? It's not just yo mama jokes for us. When I give these talks in person, I begin with call and response because I was raised in the church. So those of you who are Black churchgoers say, you know, the pastor says good morning. You say good morning back to the pastor. You don't ignore him and sit there and thumb through your phone. You stop for that moment and interact with them. And additionally, when I give these talks in person and I have Black folk in the audience, as soon as I say something like colored people time, Black folk are in the audience like, mm-hmm. Actually, Indian folk are in the audience like that too. Like, mm-hmm, we know what you're talking about, right? Because that give and take, that call and response to me is deeply important, and it's deeply constitutive of a moment where the speaker and the audience get to share the podium, the space. And so that's the other reason why I chose it as well. That's an excellent question. And that's probably the most explanation I've had to do on that in a minute. So I thank you for making me put that out there.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I think I see Michelle and then Sudhir. So Michelle, if you wanna unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes, so it's so funny that you were talking about call and response, because that's one thing with Zoom. I have a dog, and so I try to keep my mic muted, but then all of my mm-hmms that usually are there are muted. So I just wanted to take a second to say thank you for your awesome talk, and it's kind of been a highlight in my calendar this month, and so I was really looking forward to it, and I love your background too, the super awesome vibe that you're bringing, I'm happy to see everyone's faces, but turns out that even in the comfort of my own home, I still get my heart races a little when it's time to talk in front of a bunch of people, so bear with me with that, I have a lot of ideas and a lot of questions and responses to what you said. I'm taking two classes this quarter. I'm in Queer Desires in the Gender, Women, Sexuality Studies Department, taught by Dr. Adeyemi. Then I'm also in Society and Technology in the Communication Department, taught by Dr. Russell, who's here today. And so your discussion about your book and discussion today about libidinal economy and technoculture just really, really resonates with all of the readings that I've been taking in this quarter and thinking with. Yes, lots of thoughts. Also, just like real quick, the point about laughing and the way that you were saying how bodies will kind of disperse and erupt in laughter. I also think that's really interesting to think about alongside laughing barrels, which I learned about from Danny Giles, who was an artist that visited last year and was in residence with the Jacob Lawrence Gallery on campus, and how Black bodies were often restricted from also expressing explicit laughter in certain spaces, and would the idea of a monkey of barrels or something like that, is this idea of like having to laugh into a literal barrel to like contain your joy and like performances of emotion. But anyways, and then the thing that you, when you were talking about, users and content and network, and I think for me, one of the lingering questions that I have with your book is really sitting with users and the different ways that we might conceptualize who a user is. So that's like one thing. And then also with the conversation about Afro-pessimism and Afro-optimism. So your earlier article on the Black Hand side was really important to me, because there's just like a final sentence that you have in the conclusion that just really encapsulated this idea that Black Twitter is a relational formation, and it's not just about the in-group, but also who's not in the group as well help build that space. And I think that resonates a lot with Sadia Hartman's conceptions of Blackness as relational as well. But this idea of proposing Afro-optimism pulling from some of the queer theorists and queer of color critique that I've encountered this quarter, like for example, Nguyen Tan Hong, who has awesome theory around bottoming, and then Megan Milks, who writes about asexuality. There's this idea of like when we resist in a sort of opposition, oftentimes that can reify us back into the binary instead of actually kind of doing that dispersal image that you that you brought up earlier. So I don't know, I guess I'm just like thinking about how can we kind of queer the relationship between Afro-pessimism and Afro-optimism, and how might we like reorient ourselves. But okay, so that was like a preamble, but here's my like actual question. That was me trying to digest in front of all of you, so thanks. But okay, so what I hear you really talking about is the creation of a social body, a Black social body online, that is being created by social practices of technological practices and uses of technological artifacts and navigation of technological networks within our technoculture. But this social body is also not just created by the folks who we would identify as in the Black community, but it's also done through recognition. And so I hear you really getting at the relational import of discursive identity formation and meaning making. But so my question still kind of sits with the Black body and thinking about the Black body online, and less through optics and like seeing the Black body, for example, like in the GIFs or memes that you mentioned, but really thinking about kind of like what we're doing right now, which is like finding a lot of closeness, but also without a lot of the bodily senses that we would normally have. So you can't really, you know, if you were sitting next to me, you might have felt me get warm because I was getting nervous about having to talk, but that's missing in this space. And so, I guess I'm just like wondering about the body. I'm wondering about sex and about queer orientations and about physical sensations. I like touch and smell and taste. So, yeah. I don't know. Just what are your thoughts?
You're trying to kill me. So, two pieces. So, I tried to really be diligent about talking about digital practitioners rather than users. And I'm influencing this because I believe that every technology creates its users. They did not exist as those users until that technology was accepted, adopted, created, right? And so I prefer to use the idea of practitioners. I also step away from performance because while I understand how performance studies has really done a lot of valuable work on what it means to do perform self, I stick to my rhetorical roots and I talk instead about enactment, right? Because to me, enactment signifies that you have intentionality as you conduct this discursive act, and you expect, believe, understand that that intentionality will be received and acted upon. Does that make sense? So users is problematic to me because in many ways we reconfigure devices and services to serve our own needs, which then do they become the users? Like, I don't really understand. So I stick with practitioners. So that's one. The other part is I am firmly trapped within my cis heteronormative perspective. And so I have not given as much space to queer and feminist theory as I've been called out on this multiple times. On queer and feminist theory as I should have, what I do say every time, and I believe Rolina's heard me say this before, is I look forward to the work that you do when you pull that stuff out. Because it's not, you know, and Rolina can tell you, pulling together a work like this and you see the variety of sources and inspirations I have means that something's gonna get left on the cutting room floor or something gets elided because I just had no real way to articulate it. And so I encourage you to write that out and start thinking through those things, you know, on your own. Perhaps you could cite me, but you don't have to, I don't care, right? But I would love to see what you come up with, right? Third thing. I chose Afro-optimism in part, and your question about the body, because Afro-optimism, for me, Fred Moten has this really beautiful description as dancing in the graveyard of political death, meaning that we are still alive in a space that really was not built to celebrate life, it was built to commemorate death, and that dancing, that movement, he explicitly ties it to the body, is our expression of humanity in that moment where we should not be recognized, right? So I talked through the book about embodied cognition, which is where pathos comes in. I thought Christine was gonna call me out on that as well, the use of pathos and kairos, right? Because I feel like logic has a pathos, right? If you are logical, libidinally, you're supposed to suppress emotion and become objective. What happens when you elevate as, who's the woman who did epistemological standpoint? Harding? Sandra Harding, right? What happens if you elevate pathos to the mode through which you apprehend the world? So it's not just objectivity, it's subjectivity. It's the fact that you may be 5'3", and on good days I'm 6 feet, and we still are apprehending the same world, but from differential perspectives, right? The way you feel that day will shape how you view the world. So that embodied cognition is something I try to drive from to express, to understand how people bring that self to their online environment. Right, because I don't think that online is separate. I'm not a proponent of digital duality. I think that online is a further expression and informational expression of self. While the body may not be visible, it's still apprehensible. It can be apprehended through the ways people bring themselves to various conversations. How's that? That'll work? All right.
Awesome, excellent, thank you. And to answer part of that, I think that, thinking about this is what Dr. Brock is producing work in a really vibrant new field, and there's a lot of wonderful work that's coming out right now. And you might check out also Kishana Gray's work on Black feminist cyber theories. I think that might answer some of what you're looking for, Michelle. And to there, I think that you had a question as well.
Yeah, I'm relatively the literature that I'm. This is literature that's relatively new to me. So forgive my ignorance. I was just wondering what the word paraontology means and how you're using it. Or is that too broad a question? I don't know.
I'm gonna try because the book is not open in front of me. But by paraontological, I meant that if ontology is understood as what is, right? Mm-hmm. How do you determine the beingness of things? This is before being, right? And so, I stole it from Moten, who I'm pretty sure stole it from Fanon, but the idea that I exist as a bundle of intentions and bodily impulses and cultural history prior to any moment in which I am apprehended by an institution. Mm. So the ontology, if you think about it in terms of state violence against Black bodies, and I mentioned this during the talk, the what is of the carceral state is determining who has violated laws and who we can imprison. I, however, exist prior to that. Now, I may have committed a crime, but that's beside the point. In many cases, I have not, right? So if you look at the, a really good example of paraontological is I saw pictures of Black folk without masks and white folk without masks, and police circulating with both of those bodies, right? Paraontologically, both of those bodies exist, but ontologically, the police apprehended the Black people, threw them to the ground, beat them with nightsticks, arrested them, took them to jail, and were handing out masks to the white people, right? So that idea that you exist prior to that encounter is a paraontological moment. Does that help? Mm.
Yeah, yep, thank you. That's very
You're
helpful.
Welcome. Mm-hmm. Woohoo, I'm 3 for 3.
Yeah. doing well. So we have time to open it up to the floor. Are there other folks who wanna jump in there with questions? Shen?
Yeah, I can ask a question. So first, André, congratulations to your publication from such an amazing series from NYU. I'm so jealous of you for that. I'm also processing what you kind of talked about, but I have a couple questions. So one is, how do you conceptualize possibilities in your work? And with that, I really like when you said the Blackness is always already diasporic, and also that digital space was more white sociality. So for me, I like to know more about what are the transnational global implications of Blackness represented in a digital space of white sociality, and how does that link back to your conceptualization of possibilities?
That's all? That's all you want me to explain?
Yes.
I can't. I did just enough to acknowledge that there are worlds beyond the Black American context in which I was raised and which I'm trying to interrogate. And that's all I could do at this point in the book. There's marvelous work on the Black experience in the UK, the Black experience in South Africa and Tanzania and Nigeria, even the Black experience in Mexico and Brazil. This isn't that work. And so that gesture towards understanding that these diasporic presences have their own aspects of Blackness that they bring to this particular experience was important to me, but I couldn't go any deeper than that. That would have been a whole new book. I apologize. The other piece, wait, do I remember the whole question?
Yes, what are the possibilities? How do you define possibilities?
So I mentioned this briefly in the book. I talk about it more in the talks I've been giving, but there was a young woman, Kashan Thompson, who came up with the hashtag Black Girl Magic. And Black Girl Magic itself got appropriated by the Black bourgeois, the Blavity Blacks, the Blue Check bourgeoisie. It got appropriated because they used it to express their appreciation for people who had achieved in appropriate ways. Lupita Nyong'o winning an Oscar, Black women walking across the stage to get their undergraduate or graduate degrees, right? But Kashan pushed back on that. I mean, Ms. Thompson pushed back on that, and I really appreciate it. She said, Black girl magic in terms of possibility is people making a way out of no way, right? This is why I love the idea, and I'm deeply in love with my own concept of the post-present, because the post-present recognizes that you have to get past this moment, but it's not quite future planning or even future imagining. It's what you need to do to make things work in this particular moment. And so in a podcast interview, I talked, I've been saying the word this whole thing, so I'm not gonna apologize. In a podcast interview, I talked about Black technical activity when it is necessary to make something work and you don't have all the tools, pieces, or anything to work. And in my Southern community, we call that nigger rigging. Nigger rigging is a condition of possibility because it recognizes that this particular artifact, in my grandmother's case, a washing machine, needs to work in the future. So you come up with inventive ways to make it work right now, whether that is putting three rocks under the front wheel so it doesn't wobble back and forth when it's doing the spin cycle, or you put an actual belt around the engine and the agitator and the thing to make sure that it goes all the way around, right? And so it is a recognition of possibility, a future action deeply centered in the inventiveness of the ways that you can address this particular topic, right? So possibility, I leave that to the deeper philosophical implications of possibility, I leave that to Afrofuturism. But I see the things that people do on Twitter, the things that they do in the moment, right? And in other social media spaces as well, as evocative of the possibility of the now, right? I talk about Nigger Navy in my job talk, and other spaces. And Nigger Navy was interesting to me because it was a space where somebody really transgressed badly. Yahoo Business published a tweet that said, when Trump comes into office, he's going to need a Nigger Navy. And you could talk about that in terms of, well, obviously that was autocorrect, right? Because everybody's computer autocorrects bigger to nigger. But instead, Black Twitter took it as a moment of possibility, a moment of futurity, and said, what are all the ways we can play with this particular topic, right? And so I have a picture in the book, a young lady repurposed a picture that she found on the internet, this young Black woman sitting underwater in her bikini and scuba gear in a lawn chair, of all things. And she retitled this picture, Waiting for My Man to Come Home from the Nigger Navy, right? And so it's a moment of possibility, right? Schiffman talks about the use of memes as a cultural imitation, but I see it as much more. That invention and then that deployment to an audience which will be appreciative of it expands upon the possibilities of interpretation in that particular moment. And I find that to be really something common across the diaspora. I would argue it's even common across minority populations. Jewish humor is the shit, right? They were really inventive with it, right? And so you can see this in multiple immigrant communities, but for the purposes of the Black community, that discursive understanding of what we can play with now, what are the chains of signification we can turn and turn again, that is the evocation of possibility for this book. How's that? And I got to say nigger multiple times.
The interesting moment when Michelle's there's no physical presence. You don't feel the heat, just feel the silence of the Zoom. We have time for one final question. Anybody want to jump in there?
Where's Mitali? I know Mitali wanted to give me the business.
Got called out. Dr. Brock called you out.
How are you, Dr. Brock?
Hello.
Okay, so I'm really interested from a practitioner perspective. I'm probably one of the people that's not the scholars, one of the scholars on here, but one of the things that I do is team up with scholars to produce social justice interventions so that technologies do not oppress us. So one of the things that I'm really interested in, really from an IP and a legal perspective, and this is going back to the appropriation question that came through, is for those of us that sit in law and policy spaces, as we're looking at these cultural products being produced online, often in community, one of the examples I'm thinking about is hashtag activism, for example. How is it that we could work with communications folk or I love you because you understand language and you understand how Black language is evolving online, but I am often speaking with federal level policymakers or others who don't even understand language, right? They don't, wait, let me put my camera on. So can you provide any type of guidance around how we can communicate these out to audiences who are ultimately gonna look at how value is created on these platforms and then regulate them? Because everything that you've said, I've been like, yes, yes, Dr. Brock is killing it. But these are people who don't even know what a Zoom is. I was literally, somebody talked to me about a Zoom today. And I was like, ma'am, please don't win your election. Because we're already having hard times with the COVID and you don't really understand. You know, we're having hard times out here, us Black people. So could you speak a little bit more about how can we get the cliff notes? How can we engage communication scholars to the question before around queer theory and methodologies? That's also not my wheelhouse. So for those of us that are not conversant, I would have a similar answer to you, but just generally, like, how do we pull you guys in?
So, one of the reasons why I talk as much about whiteness, and I closed my talk out talking about whiteness, is that libidinal economy for Black technoculture is important, but you should also understand libidinal economies of white technoculture, particularly when it comes to capitalism. I feel like we have now begun to see much more clearly how racial capitalism works with the opening of Georgia and Texas and Missouri and all these other places, but also race and medicine, as Alondra Nelson talks about in her DNA, and Rura does as well, right? So the key for, I think, policymakers is to understand that you can apply these approaches of specificity of cultural impulses to the ways that technologies are deployed. Let me explain. So if you look at Florida said that they were going to open up, they were going to follow the Congress dictate and pay people who are unemployed not only their unemployment stipend, but an additional $600. However, Florida designed its unemployment online system to be as difficult as possible, right? In part because of longstanding beliefs and policies about Black and Latino workers that they were lazy and simply would not work if you gave them too much money. You still see this now, where many states have implemented tip lines where employers can rat out their employees who don't want to come to work because they're going to get sick. They are now being denied their employment benefits, right? So instead of necessarily using Black technoculture as a way to understand how to appeal to Black people, I would much rather you, in your powerful position, having spoken to Congress multiple times about these issues, right, talk about white technoculture and the ways that whiteness wants to exert control over mankind and the world in order to produce a particular set of desirable outcomes. And in many cases, those desirable outcomes may be clothed in the rhetorics of justice and equity and democracy and innovation, but in their application, Uber, right, they are often ways to further disrupt and disenfranchise people who, for no fault of their own, are caught on the wrong side, I'm sorry, on the caught in the apprehension of whiteness and its desire for control. Does that make sense? You mentioned hashtag activism to start off, and hashtag activism has always been interesting to me, because if you talk to activists who have learned how to work social media platforms, they will tell you most hashtags don't pop. No. Right? It takes multiple tries for a hashtag to get to the point where people start to take it up and produce content behind it and spread it to their friends. Right? So a hashtag is a deliberate, it's never just simply a viral moment that people are like, oh, that's cool. It's people who have put in the work to make sure that they have the libidinal grounding for the type of work they do. So Ferguson and Michael Brown and even Trayvon before him would not have worked if people hadn't, Black folk hadn't already come to these networks to express their joy and pain in measure, right? Without those people being familiar with a space where they could express themselves and their emotions, those hashtags would not have popped. So when you see governments trying to deploy hashtags because they're like, oh, if we get a hashtag, we'll immediately get people to pick up on things. Then you get stuff like Idaho, like meth, we're on it, right? Where they wanted to try to promote this campaign where they were trying to shut down that particular meth crisis. And that was the hashtag they came up with, right? I'm like, I don't think that's doing what you think it's going to do, right? So it does require a knowledge of linguistic capacity and semiosis, meaning making, but it's much more, I think, from your perspective as a policy person and as a legal person, it's much more interrogating what Kimberly Crenshaw and the legal crits were looking at. What is the differential access that people are going to have once these policies are enacted, and how can we use information to communicate Medicare for all, right? Do we go with death panels? That worked. I mean, I hate the right, but the right has a command of social media rhetoric that is amazing, right? They have tapped into the idea that these things are deeply effective because they draw upon pre-existing wells of racism, xenophobia, and the like, right? The left doesn't have that. We want people to be thoughtful and critical and the like, and those spaces are not necessarily as associated with the catharsis, the libidinal, as they should be. Which is why people try to focus on hashtags, but it requires deeper thought than simply saying, let me put together six words that are title case and try to capture people's attention. It's a lot of work behind it.
But I also think, it's good, but I also think just in terms of monetizing that and
why must you monetize it?
Through intellectual property, like enacting intellectual property to say, you created such and such, and then that's not a thing.
It's not important.
But it's so powerful for brands. I feel like if we could change the business model, but using this rhetorical argument.
The fact that you move to brands is in itself problematic, right? Because, so I talk about-
You don't have my white people. Like, you don't know where I live. Oh, this is the language that they understand.
And you guys,
as communicators, but specifically as communicators that understand how language is deployed online, are not in these conversations. Instead, it's me DMing you after they've made me cry because they don't get what I'm talking about. I guess that's where all my questions with your work. I love your work. I think it's brilliant. But I also challenge you to try and figure out ways to distill it so that people who probably do have Ivy League degrees but operate on like an eighth grade level of understanding are going to be able to
bring Paul out of this,
you know, are going to be able to be exposed to these ideas, because I do believe in it, and it's because I'm an optimist that in this post-COVID moment we can actually rush in and try.
The what? The post-whoop?
Post-COVID moment. Like, it's going to finish at a point, but we can rush in and, like, trick people into doing better and being more equitable and helping the people that, in my opinion, make social media a place that all people want to come to are somehow... Are somehow in that business model.
You are so utopian. It's so sweet.
You called on me. I was minding my own business.
Because I wanted to hear you, because you do dope shit. So I will say, and I'm deeply influenced by Derek Bell's racial realism theory. Right. And so some of y'all are nodding, some of you are not. Derek Bell has argued that he will always recognize the existence of racism and devote his life to fighting it, while acknowledging that it is something that he has to live with but doesn't have to recognize. Does that make sense? I said it.
That makes sense.
Close enough, right? And so there will never be a moment when all people come together on social media. Even prior to that, we already differentiate ourselves based on our sexuality, our gender, our race, or whatever. So having that thought is kind of what got us into this trouble in the first place, right? Instead, let me back up. So I wrote this book not to solve a problem. So those of you who have written dissertations, when I defended my dissertation on Hurricane Katrina's aftermath and looters versus finders, I was asked by a very well-meaning white person whether my dissertation will solve racism. No. they want it to be that. Yes. Yes. Right. He now has a PhD, but this is the type of questioning you get. Instead, I wanted to point to problematics. I do nuance. Like, I'm not the polemic. And so I love the work of Ruha and Sophia. They do what's wrong with this system really good, right? That's not where this work is intended to go. This work is saying, look, there are interstitial possibilities for joy and vitality among the moments where we experience microaggressions, right? Among the moments where we're trying to figure out which bill to pay this month, we still have fun, right? Not just fun, we exist in ways that celebrate ourselves. Right, so it will never be easily translatable to the type of work you want to do,
right?
Unless you take the broader, the second level meaning that I had behind it, the way I tried to close the book out was saying this particular cultural specificity is applicable to whiteness as well. When you determine what the libidinal intensities of whiteness are, when it applies to law, the carceral, the technical, and any other thing, you will begin to understand why things go in particular ways, and you can devote your energies not to breaking them, because you'll never break them, but diverting them so that what you'll get what Bell called interest convergence.
Okay. Right?
Where at some point, your desires will mesh with the desires of white people, like the abolitionists and the suffragists, right? And you can get to that moment where things work for a moment, realizing that it's not gonna be a permanent coalition. It can't be, it won't be. Sorry.
Okay, well, I'm not in the business of solving racism, but I am in the business of challenging systems and using the tools that I have. Just so that we're clear.
I understand, but okay. I admire your perspective. That's why I called on you, right? You do dope shit, right? And so I love being able to have this conversation with you, even if my response is kind of like I can't really help you, but I feel like I can help you. Once you start to unpack what I'm doing and saying, well, what are white people doing? Why is this particular law this way? Instead of, like, if you talk about prison abolition, right, in the context of COVID, why are they not letting prisoners free in these hotspots that prisons have become, right? That's not, right? That's a racial issue. It becomes a racial issue, much more so than it is a carceral issue, because they feel that black people are inherently criminal and will recommit crimes once they get back out. They don't believe in prison as a place for rejuvenation, or what's the other word? That's not, rejuvenation is the right word, where they fix them, right? They believe in prison as a punishment. So yeah, once you start understanding the libidinal intensities of whiteness, things will open up for you. I promise, I swear.
Okay.
What were you gonna say? And on that note, thank you very much, Dr. Brock, for all of your provocations today. Lots of clapping. Thank you so much for joining us. Yay, you can unmute for the claps. And please join us in 2 weeks from today for Dr. Shinsuke Eguchi for his colloquium. Yeah, he's right there. If you have not yet registered, you can go to the Communication Department website, com.washington.edu. It's on the big banner there, and click and register for it. And everyone have a wonderful night. Check out Dr. Brock's book.
Don't leave
yet. Oh, yeah, please.
Thank you, Relina. Thank you, Christine. Thank you, Anu. I saw Anu at the bottom. Thank you, Megan. Thank you all for making this such a joyful moment in the shitty week that I've had. Right, I really appreciate having the time to talk about my work with people who are interested in it. And even if I do talk a lot of philosophical shit, I feel like you guys were working with me. And so I really appreciate having this moment. Thank you for having me.